Ara's coat of arms, which give you already some hints of its rich history. The golden lion rampant on the Holy Roman Germanic Empire, of the Holy Roman Germanic Empire, with the the inscription of the county of Artois in the middle. With three red towers, in which you have three castles, meaning total nine castles, and a background of fleur-de-lis. So you see already the challenge. Arras belong both to France, to Artois, and to the Holy Roman Germanic Empire for a big part of its history. Dia, geography is a main determinant of history. Gordon, Dia. Geography is a main determinant of history. So, let's look. Oh, the one before. Gordon, you jumped twice. Yeah, this one. You see Arras almost in the middle. And on the upper left, Great Britain, the English Channel, the Strait of Dover, that we call in French Pas-de-Calais, on the name of the city Calais, it's a strait, as you see, and pas in like a step in French means also a strait. And that geographical name, Pas-de-Calais, has given its name to the adjacent department. Arras is currently the capital city of Pas-de-Calais, which is a department, in the Hauts-de-France region. It's also the capital of the province of Artois. Arras is almost at the same distance to Paris, Brussels, and London. Coming from Italy, when you aim to Great Britain, after Reims, which is at the bottom of that Google map, you meet Arras before reaching Calais. So you see, it's on the way from Italy to Great Britain, but coming from Amiens, which is almost in the center, but on the left, on the way to Brussels, Belgium, again, you go by Arras. And you meet then a city which is not on that particular Google map for the road. We meet Tournai, which is in Belgium, but very close to the French border, close to Lille. We will speak a couple of times about Tournai, so I want you to know where it is. Dia. So, we were speaking about the roads, but there are rivers too that have really played an important role. Arras lies on the Scarp River, which is a tributary of the Scheldt in English and Escaut in French. And you see that the Escaut or Scheldt River go up to Anvers, Antwerpen in Flemish, and the North Sea. And that was also another determinant of its history. Next slide, Dia. My native city holds so many historical and artistic assets that I had to choose and to order them. As the order is concerned, I have decided to proceed mostly, but not only, in a chronological order. And for the selection, first, I kept in mind that England, Scotland, and Ireland were among the founding nations of Montreal. And secondly, starting in the 18th century, I will have a family bias, you will see, because my ancestors participated in the construction and the embellishment of Arras. So, we will see, first, the Gallo-Roman period, with the Atrebates, then we jump to the 6th century with the beginning of Saint-Vaast Abbey, then to 9th, 15th century When Arras became a free town with bankers and lost textile and poets such as Jean Bedel and Adam de la Halle. Next period, Arras is at the heart of the European diplomacy, but with a lot of war as well as peace treaty during the 15th and 16th century, finally back to France during the 17th century. 17th and 18th century were prestigious prestigious period for architecture in Arras. At the time of the French Revolution, if we speak of Arras, we have to speak about Maximilien de Robespierre, so it will be just a little bit. 19th century Renaissance with artists like Constant Dutilleux, a painter, and more. First World War I, and Canadians were very present in Arras, as well together with the British. They were part of course, the Commonwealth. And the Reconstruction with the Art Deco period. And finally, what you can see nowadays. So you see, it's quite a program. So, slide 5, Nemetacum or Nemetosena. That was the name of Arras. It was the chief town of the Atrebat, one of the last Gallic peoples to surrender Julius Caesar. And you see that that city was actually not that far away from Durocortorum, Remorum, which is now Reims. That was the capital city of Gallia Bellica. Gallia Bellica was extending from the Seine River up to the Scheldt. Up to the Rhine River. So that was quite an extensive area. At that time, the city of Arras was built on a sacred hill called Bodimont. Well, some British will tell me, some people from England, hey, the Atrebats, we have Atrebats in England. Yes, you do. The chief of the Atrebats, Com, was actually became quite a good friend of Julius Caesar. But at the time when all the general, at the time of the general Gallic uprising, Comnius did not stand alongside its leading chieftain Vercingetorix, but he was nevertheless one of the organizers of the relief army attempting to break the siege of Alesia and to liberate Vercingetorix. After the capitulation of the Gauls, Commius continued a guerrilla campaign against Caesar's legions, some I guess will say Caesar. And in 51 BC, after negotiating his surrender, because he was not only a very good warrior, he was also quite a diplomat, he ultimately took exile in southern England, where he founded the Atrebat Kingdom. So that's one of the link my city has with Great Britain. It goes up to Caesarea. Drapers and fabrics manufacturing in Arras were already famous in Roman time. Because of a special microorganism, the Crinchon Brook, an affluent of Scarpe River, had dictatorial properties. And in the Latin reading, you can see that sentence from Trebellius, or rather written by Trebellius Pollio, he was Gallienus who told that, can the state, meaning the Roman state, be safe without the Atrebates' coats? You remember the coats, the Roman liked the purple color, and the best clothes with purple color were already coming from Arras. I can point it, but you may see on that map, that Roman map, not only the roads, because the Romans were road builders, and that was so important for us. But you can see that little river in the south. Actually, it was several branch that Crinchon River, and that's where you have that those special microorganism giving that beautiful color that they liked so much. Okay, next slide. Thank you. Let's jump to the 6th century, and again we are going to speak about British because we are going to speak about Saint-Va, who is venerated also in Great Britain under the name of Foster. In French, it's Gaston, and the Latin name is Vedastus. Clovis, King of Franks, while returning from his victory over the Alemannic at Tolbiac, hastened to Reims to receive baptism and stop at Toul to request some priest to instruct him on the way. Vedaste was assigned to accompany the king. On the way, extraordinary healings were attributed to Vedaste that further convinced the king of the Franks to adopt his wife's religion. Clovis became a Christian in a ceremony at Reims on Christmas 496, and Vedas became an advisor to King Clovis. In 499, Remigus, in Latin, let's call him just by his French name, Remy, the Bishop Remy, named Va, the first Bishop of Arras. Around 510, he was also given oversight over Cambrai. Slide 9. I mean, next slide. Dia. The Royal Abbey of Saint-Vaast, a Benedictine monastery, was later founded in his honor on the right bank of the Crinchon Brook in 664 by the Bishop Aubert. It was of great importance among the monasteries of the Low Countries and had a remarkable scriptorium, that is, a library where the illuminated manuscripts were copied by hand. It was exempt from episcopal jurisdiction and maintained its independence until 1778, so you see 11 years before the French Revolution, when it aggregated to the Congregation de Cluny. Okay, thank you. A new town thrived under its protection, which took the name of Arras, a contraction of Atrebats, by the 12th century. It attracted people from the surrounding Artois countryside, and Arras went up to 25,000 inhabitants. They were encouraged to attend free school at the abbey, and when new stealing fruits in the monks' orchards became a problem, the monk decided to sell them plots for a modest price, plots of land, where they could build a home with a small garden. The monks acted like urbanists, and newcomers became spinners, fullers, weavers, and dyers. So that was the whole treatment of the wool that was already so famous that just kept on, thanks to the monk, because we must say that the Frankish and other invasion, Viking invasion and so on, had really perturbed a lot that industry of wool in Arras. On that map, you see how on the left of the Crinchon Brook, you had the Gallo-Roman city left with its cathedral that was built on the former temple to Gallic deities, and it's on the right of that Crunchon River that the city really thrived. But you could see also that that very there is a road going in diagonal, the way you had seen it on the very first slide. It's still the Gallo-Roman road from the sea, from Terouanne to Cambrai. And that street still exists nowadays. You can see also on that map two markets, one called Petit Marché, small market, that was a vegetable market, and one called Grand Marché, a large market, shall we say, that was the and that is still, I must say, the market for textile. Those two squares still exist, and we will speak a lot about them, as well as the abbey. The new town was administrated by elected aldermen and a mayor who put into force their decisions, while the episcopal city was answerable to the King of France directly. To be noted that in 1092, the Pope Urban II, former canon in Reims, decided that the Church of Arras will elect its bishop, and is Lambert de Guignes from Lille, was unanimously elected by the clergy and the people at that time. We'll speak of Lambert a little bit more again. So you see, we had the root of democracy in that city already one millenary away, 10 centuries away. Slide 11. In 1111, the Arras bourgeois were already represented by aldermen, and in 1191, the Atrebat's land that was part of Flanders was given to the King of France, Philippe Auguste, and was incorporated into the royal estate of France a few years after in 1223. Philippe Auguste transformed France from a small feudal state into the most prosperous and powerful country in Europe at that time. It checked the power of the nobles and helped towns free themselves from seigneurial authority, granting privileges and liberties to the emergent bourgeoisie. Arras is the first known free town. Next slide. In the city, the Carolingian and Romanesque cathedral had become too small, and in 1160, the construction of a huge Gothic cathedral similar to Reims, or Amiens, or Orléans, or Notre-Dame de Paris was started. Yes, we used to have one of the most beautiful Gothic cathedrals. Next slide, dear. According to tradition, there was a terrible epidemic that was given the name the Hellfire that ravaged the countryside in the year of 1105. It was called Le Mal des Ardents or Evil of Ardent. And it caused a kind of gangrene in the limbs and terrible suffering in all parts of the body. Itinerant musicians wandering from town to town were called jongleurs or minstrels. There were at the time two minstrels, one named Itier, who live in Brabant, who is now in Belgium, and the other named Normand, who live in Saint-Paul, not very far from Arras, who had vowed a mortal hatred as Normand had killed Itier's brother. One night, they both had the same dream. The Virgin Mary, dressed in white, appeared to them and told them to go to the cathedral. Norman, who was closer arrived first. As he entered the cathedral, he saw all the patients who had taken refuge there. He told the bishop Lambert of the apparition, but the bishop thought that Norman was mocking him and sent him away. Itty arrived the following day and also spoke to the bishop. When the bishop told Itty that someone named Norman had come to tell him of the same vision, Itty asked where he was, because he intended to kill him on the field to avenge his brother's death. Bishop Lambert then understood that the Blessed Virgin had sent two men to be reconciled. The bishop spoke to each separately and then put them in each other's presence and asked them to give each other the keys of peace, and then spent the night in prayer inside the cathedral. It was Pentecost Day, and about 3 o'clock in the morning, so in the year 1105, when the Virgin Mary appeared to the two minstrels in the cathedral, carrying a lighted candle in the hands, she gave the men the candle intended for the healing of the sick and explained to them what they must do. Next slide. A few drops of the wax then that fell from the candle were to be mingled with water, giving it miraculous properties. The people would then drink. All who believed were healed. The two minstrels, now brothers, distributed the miraculous water, and the epidemic was stopped, for the patient would regain their health after the drink of the water mixture. And the lesson for that was that reconciliation and magnanimous action can precipitate great miracles, such as curing diseases, ending natural disasters, as well as ending or preventing wars. And along the century, that story has been illustrated in many ways in Arras. And what you have seen, it's here on the slide, it's a glass window, Art Deco, that have been replacing the former one in a church called Saint-Nicolas-en-Cité just after the First World War that did so much destruction. That's something we'll see later on. Next slide. So we have spoken about minstrels. They were so numerous in the Artois region, but some were more famous than others. Minstrel was the name given to those musicians who were going from one city to the other. And we will call trouvère in north of France the one who were closer to the aristocratic community and were sure to have some work, conversely to the minstrel. Actually, in Arras, there was quite a mix between them. So, one of those very famous artists that was born in Arras was no, the previous one, Jean Bedel. Sorry, or maybe you have already read about Jean Bedel. He was born and died in Arras. He was indeed a joncleur and epic poet, author of fabliau and dramatist, and he composed Le Jeu de Saint-Nicolas, which was the very first miracle play in French, in French language, because before it was always in Latin. So that was quite a step in the French literature. After Jean Bedel came Adam de la Halle, also known as Adam le Bossu or Adam the Hunchback. He was a trouvère, poet and musician, as well as his father and his grandfather. And he is the author of Le Jeu de Robin et Marion, a musical play which is considered to be the earliest surviving secular French play. with music. He was a member of the confrérie of jongleurs, which means also minstrel, et bourgeois d'Arras, which mean that there was that those very close links between people who liked music and those traders, the bourgeois who were also manufacturers. Hein? Arras became the town with 80 poets. It was a flourishing literary center, and it was said that when God was tired to see the French seigneurs fight with each other, he will come down to Arras to rest, to have a break in this pleasant and kind society. We will listen to some music by Adam de la Halle, Je mouir d'amourette, by the Lamora Ensemble, while we will see five slides with carvings and paintings by artists from Arras at that time.
I will play the music, but because it's a YouTube, we won't be able to see the slides. We'll see the slides after Thérèse, okay? We'll listen.
Okay.
It's a very short music. It's only about
yeah, it's short.
Not even two minutes. So
yeah.
I'll start the YouTube.
Okay. Okay, back to the slide now.
So, let me just. There we go. All right, so perhaps you may have some comments on the slides, guys. This is 17.
You see, it beautiful music, beautiful literature. You could go to the theater and so on. But there were also carvers, and you see those beautiful, very fine angels that used to be in the cathedral. I can say it right now, that beautiful Gothic cathedral was dismembered at the time of the French Revolution. We'll come back on that later. But those pieces, those small angels can be seen at the Museum of Fine Art in Arras. Here, see the expression of that Christ on the cross. Very fine carving too. Next slide. Arras sculptures were known not only in the city itself, but look, Philippe Trisebault of Burgundy, well, of France, sorry, called some sculpture from Arras to carve its canopy and its face. You can see this one at the metro in New York City. You know, Met. When it's written Met, it means it's at the Met. Next slide. Which means we exported our sculpture. And here is Notre Dame des Ardents we have spoken of. It's a 14th century statue, and you see how gracious she is, with looking at her baby. That's rather rare, you know. In many many virgin statues, the virgin look very cold and look away. Here you have really a mother, very gracious person, and that one you can see it in Arras, in Saint Jean Baptiste. Here is some painting on canvas from a monastery very close to Arras that doesn't exist anymore. This one too is at the Met. Next one. The Guédama Refuge for the friars of Mont-Saint-Éloi Abbey. Many people, even in Arras, don't know about that refuge, which actually is the only medieval building that is still standing in Arras. But I felt it was important to tell about it to you, because that refuge had a tunnel from its underground up to that abbey of Mont-Saint-Éloi. And Mont-Saint-Éloi, we will speak again of that abbey when we speak of World War WW1 and of the Vimy Vimy Crest and Vimy Ridge Battle. Okay, so actually, what does it mean, Guédama? It's very well, it's a French word from that time. From the 12th century, actually, that meant a ford in the water, in the river. And the river was actually the Crinchon Brook, on which a lady, Emma, built had a mill built. And Emma, it's a deformation of the name Emma. Emma Crespin was the first known owner of that mill, and there are still people from that Crespin family in Arras presently. So, let's go to the next slide. Yes, indeed. You know, when Shakespeare first performed Hamlet in 1600, Polonius was killed behind an arras. And so most of you know that, because of that, that arras means a tapestry, a hanging tapestry. So let's see that very special art. Next slide.
Why?
That I will show you just a few. This tapestry, you can presently see it in Tournai Cathedral. I spoke to you of that Belgian town, Tournai. It just happened that someone from Arras was elected in Tournai and gave as a present that those beautiful tapestry hangings to the cathedral. And that's a very good thing for us, because it's the eldest Arras, real Arras tapestry that we still have, while we know that there were many, many that were made, that were fabric. And it's the story of Saint Pierre and Saint Eleuthère, which are saints of the Tournai area. Huh? So next slide. That was 1402. This one, I must say, is the one I prefer. And you can see it in the Museum of Fine Arts in Arras. And you see the small white rabbit? That's one of the characteristics of Arras. Usually you have three. Here indeed, you have three rabbits, one on the left and two other on the right. The white rabbit, the flowers, you know, it's so fine. And look at the dress of Saint-Va. Saint-Va, the one who gave its name to the abbey, that dress, it looks like velvet. It's you have the feeling that you feel it, you know, it's so fine, really so fine after so many century. And I really advise you, if you go to Arras, to go to the Museum of Fine Arts and to look at it, to admire it, and to admire how fine that work is. Actually, the way it was done is that painter will provide some kind of water painting on cardboard, and so it was just like a sketch. And so they were really the tapissier will the weaver will interpret those drawings and do that magnificent work. Next slide. That's how a tapestry like this one, The Gift of the Heart, is named by the master of Arras if you go to Germany or to Flanders. But if you go to the Louvre in Paris, where it's actually exposed, they are more ambivalent because the drawing was done by someone from Paris. Well, look, actually, everybody knew that the best weaver, the best maker of tapestry were people from Arras. So they were sending sketch from everywhere. And I feel that because of the additional value brought by the one we're weaving, that really all the credit should be given to Arras. Next one, next slide. That's another example. That one is tapestries in Great Britain, Deer Hunt. There too, it's possible that the drawing was from somewhere else, but the weaving was made in Arras. Next slide. You see, the previous one was 1440. And this one, you still see how fine it is. Huh? And it's later, it's 1495, the period at the end of 15th century. Is it an Arras or not? No, actually, it's a Tournai. And why so? We are going to see that. What kind of very sad event led to that. This one, you can see it at the Met in New York City. So, next slide. Well, that's why Arras tapestry became Tournai's tapestry. In 1477, Louis the 11th, the King of France, was visiting the city of Arras that actually he knew very well because he was a mischievous adolescent, rebellious toward his father, and he had escaped at his uncle's place in Burgundy, and at that time Arras was part of Burgundy. So living with his uncle in Belgium, like what is presently in Belgium, he visited many times Arras and knew how beautiful that city was. And so when he became the King of France, he really wanted to have the obedience of Arras people, and sent his ambassadors, as it was done at that time, to prepare his visit. And the elder man in Arras answered, "We will receive the King of France with all the honors due to his condition, but we will not bow down because the ambassador had asked, they told that the king wanted that the aldermen bow down in front of the king. Say, no, 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 we bow down only in front of God. And according to the Royal Chronicles, written by Louis XI secretary, Louis XI got in Arras the most magnificent reception he never had, better than anywhere else. It lasted for a week. There were plays. There were plays in every sense of the word, not only at the theater. And you know how good musicians and good theaters they had in Arras. But you will see very soon how they had square that really allow real checkers, for instance, and chess. And since the aldermen did not bow down, the king was very upset. And at the time of leaving to Paris, he left the city early in the morning, as it was planned, review his army, which was quite normal. The army was always traveling with the king and staying just beside the walls, outside the walls, you know, but just close by. And then the army started to move, but rather than going to Paris, it went inside Arras. And of course, you know, Arras people were not ready to, well, they fight very, very well, but still, you know, it was something just terrible. Arras was completely destroyed. The walls were razed. Its inhabitants were ousted. And the name Arras was even abolished by the king, Louis XI, and replaced by the name Franchise. And in order to have people for the new place, the king ordered that other cities in the kingdom of France had to send trade people to Arras. That was something really terrible, such a betrayal. So, next slide. We'll go rather fast. I will not go into detail about the different treaties that were signed, peace treaties that were signed in Arras, and also the different war, because it's a little bit complicated. And but I want to show you that picture. That is the treaty between Charles VII of France and Philip the Good of Burgundy, because on the right you have British people with a red cross on their clothes. Initially, the three were concerned because it was after the War of 100 Years, but only France and Burgundy signed and the British went away. But it just to illustrate how those historical events were depicted with very, very nice enluminure. So next slide. Well, the city of Arras went back to the Spanish, and they are the Spanish, and especially Charles V, Carlos Quintos in Spanish, who rebuilt the city. And they rebuilt it the way it was built before. You see the city on one side and the town on the other side, and the big market square for textile trade and the small square for vegetable square. The other square, which is rather important, does exist still now. It's the theater square, but the theater arrived only in the 19th century, and at that time it was a fish market. Okay, and you see, of course, at the center of the city, Saint-Va Abbey. Next slide. Here, see, it may not be the best by far the best picture of Arras Beffroi, Beffroi, I mean Belfry, I mean, and City Hall. But I show it to you because you see in front on that petite place, small market, hein, you see this line. It's the one where it was the most evident. And actually, the whole square was literally divided in smaller square. And that's how you see also there is a balcony on the city hall. From that balcony of the city hall, the guest, and Louis XI was one of them, could have could play chess with people who were alive. So the first building that was erected was a belfry, which is of Gothic style. It's at the time of Carlos Quintos, and that's why, to thank him, the alderman decided to put an imperial crown at the very top, his imperial crown. That belfry is now labeled by UNESCO a World Heritage. Compared with a keep that was a symbol of seigneur, and the bell tower that was a symbol of the church, the belfry, the third tower in the urban landscape, symbolized the power of the aldermen. Over the centuries, they came to represent the influence and wealth of the town. Next slide. Thank you. We'll go very fast over this slide. I want just to pinpoint that Abbé, Saint-Va Abbé, was really a catalyzer of peace. You see that it's in that Abbé that was created what was called the Union of Arras between the county of Hainaut, county of Artois, the cities of Douai, Lille, Orchy, and Arras, who pledged loyalty to Spain, and while the North kept on fighting against Spain, and that's how the North became independent and became the Netherlands, and the South became much later Belgium and part of France. Next slide. Next. Okay, that's just to illustrate how those bourgeois were liked arts and really encouraged painters. On the left, it's at the Metropolitan. You see that picture of a trader. On the right, the tombstone of one of those bourgeois who was enterré in tomb in Saint Baptiste Church, and that's something you can still see. At the same time, yeah, next slide. Yeah, the church was very eager to have the people learn about their religious teaching, and they did not hesitate to have very good painter to come and. And you see, for instance, that beautiful, really beautiful painting of La Descente de Croix by Rubens that was done for Saint-Va Abbé, and that now is in Saint Jean-Baptiste Church in Arras. Of course, you know, well, you have seen before some, okay. So, here is something very special in Arras that you can still see. Mont de Piété, there is a Latin inscription, Mons Pietatis, 1624. It was built by an Anvers architect, Wenceslas Kubberberg, who was mandated by the governor of Low Countries, Albert and Isabel d'Austria, you know, from Austria. That was the Habsburg, and those emperors were very concerned about high borrowing rate, and Arras indeed, since it was a city of trade, not only for textile but also for cereal, for animals, and so on, had a lot of bankers, and sometimes you had very high rate when you were borrowing. That house, that building, Mont Piété, was completely destroyed during the First World War, and it was rebuilt identically in 1920s. And it was in activity up to the Second World War. Next slide. So here is a map just to remind you, some of you at least, that Cyrano de Bergerac, who is the subject of the classic French play by Edmond Rostand, participated in the 1640 siege of Arras. The French people were fighting the Spanish. The Spanish were inside the city, and the French people were fighting to get back Arras. Arras became Spanish by marriage, but it went back to France by the war. Next slide. This looked terrible, I apologize, but some of you have already seen that map. Well, I find it so bad. I went to take a picture of it 2 weeks ago because I thought that really I should show it to you. And if you go at my guild faculty club, it's on the second floor, just before taking the stair to go up to the third floor. And you will see on the wall, it's big, big map, and it's another battle of Arras, a battle fought on, in 1654 by Turenne, and against the Spanish army. At that time, it was the opposite. French people were inside, and the Spanish wanted to take back Arras. And at the very top, you have a view of the city from far, and you can see on the left Saint-Va Abbey and a church, the Belfry, and of course several churches. Let's look. I wanted to show it to you, though it's of poor. My picture is of poor quality because it's in Montreal, and why? Nobody at the faculty club was able to tell me why. And if one of you know why this map of Arras is on that wall, please tell it to me. I will be very interested by the answer. So let's look at the next slide. So finally, the King Louis XIV was still quite young, actually, was at that time was able to take back Arras, who really become French again. And on that very nice painting, you can see, as I was telling before, on the left, Saint-Va Abbey, the middle, the belfry, and a church, bell tower. So next slide. Okay, you will say, oh, they all look alike, those map of Arras with the city on one side and the town on the other side. Well, actually, here you see something that was added. The wall, and by Vauban, those who are familiar with Vauban fortification, you recognize the citadel at lower left corner, with that star shape, beautiful citadel with walls all around the city. Now the French had Arras back, they wanted to keep it, and that's why they fortified it. Now, there is something you may see in between the the town, the city, and the citadel, you have a green square. And that was what was called la basse ville, the low town. And that became a new district, and we will see how the architecture was beautiful in that new district. Next slide. If you visit the Museum of Fine Art, you will in Arras, you will see that wonderful map of Arras in relief. And that's a treasure for us because so many things were destroyed, and that allows us to know how the city was in 1716. And especially the Abbey of Saint-Va was the largest convent complex of the 18th century in the Western world at that time. Next slide. I told you about buildings. There are still a few buildings from that time, classical style. Here we see 1690, built with local limestone. And remember that, limestone. That means they were, if it was local, they were quarry. And we'll speak about that when we speak about First World War. Next slide. Here is Palais des États d'Artois. It was like a parliament. The Parliament of Artois, and that beautiful palace was built in 1724. Next slide. You need some decoration when you have a nice door. And here you have the wrought iron transom that was built above that door for that beautiful palace. It's a picture from a paper from the historical monument, and actually it's the first picture we have of the first guy called Boucher, my name, my ancestor, who came actually from Spain but lived in Amiens before moving to Arras. Yeah, you will see some more rough iron. I have 3 centuries of artists in rough iron behind me. Next one. Well, it was a century when people had a vision and they built beautiful buildings. Here is the Hotel de Guine that presently is belong to the department. It belongs to the state, let's say, and it has mostly a cultural. Well, actually, all those very nice buildings you will see have become a property of the state, either at the national level or at the regional level, and they have become buildings for the arts, for the culture. Saint-Va Abbey became the Museum of Fine Art, for instance, and here that private hotel for aristocratic people has become the cultural center of Arras. And presently, two societies that were founded at the same time the building was built, the Academy of Science and Letters and Arts, that was founded in 1737. It seems it was the first one in north of France, and maybe more. And the Rosati, that was also, that was a society of poets, but also people who liked the life and they liked to celebrate together, and they were very good friends. It was founded about the same time, and they are both presently in that cultural center that you can still visit. Next slide. That inside that beautiful house, the ceiling. Next slide. Another beautiful hostel, Hôtel de Beaufort, that was built about that time by Adrien François Duez, architect. And it became in around 1820 a college, a school for boys actually, hein? And it's presently still a school, a high school, Collège Nationalisé Jean Bodel. Actually, above the middle doors, you have a beautiful temple. Let's go to the next slide. There are so many nice buildings. And again, in that Basseville, Place Victor Hugo, you see that octagonal square that actually was used for, and still when I was a little girl, for the market for the animals. Arras is in the middle of a rural country, and so that's where horses and cows and other animals were sold. There was one day for the horses, another day for sheep, and so on, you know. And that beautiful octagonal square was designed by Pierre-Louis Beffara, who was the main architect of, let's say, urbanist, we should say. He was originally an engineer. Next slide. It's a time also when they decided they will have a nice theater. And you see it here. It was built in 1785. And you can still see it because it was rebuilt identically after the war when it suffered. Next slide. Well, the arts was not only in big buildings, it was also in small things. And there are unmarried ladies, sisters, les demoiselles de Lemaire, who decided to have their factory and to manufacture plates and balls and cups and so on. And so you had a very fine porcelain d'Arras. In the 20th century, a family, Caudron, whom I have quite well known, decided that that should be started again. And so what you see in the picture at the top, it's actually initially porcelain from Limoges, but the Limoges factory were just preparing the shape, and it was shaped from the ancient shape from Arras, and they were shipped to Arras where they were decorated. First painted those that with that typical blue branches, and then glaze and cook. You have to cook between each process, and unfortunately, those people, the Caudron family, who did that for several generations, they all passed away, and nobody anymore does that. Next slide. Well, we cannot speak about Arras without speaking about Robespierre. Robespierre was a lawyer. He was born in Arras. His father was a lawyer. His grandfather was a lawyer too. And is it because he lost his mom when he was 8? He was sent to live with his grandparents, and his sister were sent to live somewhere else, and so on. Well, that very bright child, actually, who became himself a lawyer, if you had lived at the time that, before the French Revolution, you will have certainly elected him, because he was against slavery, he was in favor of a lot of things that we have now, liberation of women and so on. And so you will have certainly voted for him. He was against the death penalty also. But so he was elected. He was a very influential member during the revolution. He signed, of course, the death of the king. Well, he signed the death of the king. And I told you that he was against death penalty. So how come? And anyway, he is the one who went to comment with a few friends like Danton and so on, and who imposed the terror. So we can say, to some, he was the revolution's principal ideologist and embodies the country's first democratic experience, but to others, he was the incarnation of the terror that followed. Remember that actually, a lot of that democratic experience had been living for real in France for centuries, while it was not so in the remaining of France. Anyway, he finally had, next slide, he had so many deaths, he signed so many deaths. Finally, he was himself ousted and decapitated, and here is his severed head once again at the Met. We can say that he really behaved like a leader of a sect or a cult. Next slide. Well, all the Catholic building, all the church in Arras, were all dismembered during the French Revolution, except the Saint John the Baptist that was destroyed during the First World War. We'll speak about that later on. So, except for that church, Saint John the Baptist, even the Gothic cathedral was dismembered, and the stones were sold to Flemish traders for buildings. You may find stones from the Gothic Arras Cathedral far away in Netherlands because of those revolutionaries. When Napoleon the First visited Arras, people from Arras asked him to have back their cathedral and Saint-Va Abbey. Well, Napoleon told, look, you know, Saint-Va Abbey, that was built before the revolution, but not quite terminated, was already quite big. It's big enough for a cathedral. So I'm going to subsidize you in order that it become your cathedral. And there is no way we will rebuild the Gothic cathedral, but you might have a smaller church at that place, and that's what happened. It's Saint-Nicolas en Cité. So here are the plans for Saint-Va Cathedral. That was initially the chapel of the abbey, and that was rebuilt as a cathedral in 1807. Next slide. Here is the bishop who really was very, very, was key in the building of that cathedral, Monseigneur de la Tour de Vennes. He's quite well known in France because he was the first bishop to sign the Concordat with Napoleon. That means an agreement between the state and the church. And you may know that all the church in France nowadays belong to the state. And he was ready to do some kind of agreement. And it's thanks to him that we got that beautiful cathedral you will see later on. Next slide. I like especially in that cathedral that wooden eagle. It's so beautiful. Unfortunately, I was unable to find from what century it is and who did it, but it's just beautiful. Next slide. Okay, by the time the cathedral was built, we needed statue. And I told you that all the church became the property of the state. So the what is presently the Pantheon in Paris used to be a church, Saint Genevieve Church, and they had statue built for Saint Genevieve. But since it was decided it will become the Pantheon, those statues were useless. And so someone in Paris, close to the powerful people, had that idea that maybe those statue could be sent to Arras. And indeed, that's how we inherited of Saint Genevieve Church statue. They are beautiful statue, and they are all Parisian saint, of course, since they were for a Paris church. Next slide. During that time, some more beautiful houses were built, and I like particularly that one, which is in a small street, which is called Rue du Collège, because the Jesuits had their school just beside, again, before the French Revolution. And the people who have gone to Arras and stay at the Hôtel de l'Univers, that used to be the favorite hotel for British, the former Jesuit College was at the where now is the Hôtel de l'Univers. And Hôtel de l'Univers is just beside that private hotel, which is currently the Notary Chamber. Next slide. A concert hall was built. We had a theater, but you know, concert hall was needed too, of course, because of Arras had, again, very vivid artistic activity. Next slide. Next. Next. Diapo. Thank you. Well, I'm sure you have heard about Camille Corot, and you know several of his landscapes. At least one of them is at the Museum, Fine Art Museum of Montreal. There are not that many people who know that Camille Corot has also done some portraits. And that particular one is most likely the portrait of a girl from Arras, since it was given by the artist Corot to his friend Georges Camus. Next slide. Corot had a pupil who was named Constant Dutilleux, who became quite a great painter. And when you see that painting, you may think it's by Corot. Actually, it's by Constant Dutilleux, and it's Scarpe River in Arras. Next one. Constant Dutilleux painted both landscape, but is more known in Arras by his portrait, because he portrayed all those bourgeois of Arras. And there was a big exhibit about 20 years ago at the Grand Palais about Dutilleux. My great-great-grandfather was there, I must say. Here is a self-portrait. Next one. Constant Dutilleux decided to have a school of painting in Arras, and painting was taught in college, and it was very popular. And here you see a few painters from École d'Arras, two brothers, Jules and Émile Breton. Jules was both a painter and a poet. Émile was a painter and an engraver. Next one. Charles de Savary, another painter. And if you go to Arras Museum, you will see quite a number of those paintings. You see at the back the cathedral, hein? Saint-Va Cathedral, that had just been rebuilt after the revolution at the very back. And closer, you see all around that small port, small harbor, one building, the one which is in a whiter color, that is still standing, well, standing, because it was renovated and rebuilt, and I must say. Next slide. We have seen China before, I mean porcelain d'Arras. Arras was famous in the 19th century for its lace. And the lace of Arras was very, very similar to the one of Lille, except that it was very, very pure white, and it was much stronger than the one of Lille. The King of England, George the First, was wearing some Arras lace at the time of his coronation in 1714. So, if those pieces at the Met, they are from the 19th century, but indeed, you know, that was a tradition from the century before. But I couldn't have any picture of those materials before. And we must say that by the end of the 19th century, that industry declined. Next slide. You have seen painting and all kind of arts. There were also sculptures. I'm not sure who did those sculptures that are presently in Saint John Baptiste Church. It might be my great-granduncle, actually. You see how fine they are, the face and so on. Next time I go to Arras, I will have to go and see the signature. Next slide. This one, actually, the whole monument, was done by my father's uncle. His father was already a sculptor and marbrier. And I chose this slide for three reasons. One, we spoke about the Rosati, that particular club of poets, but who liked good living and they were very good friends. And you see that guy was living, Charles-Henri Michel, was living 60 kilometers away from Arras, but he will come regularly to the meeting of the Rosati. To the point that they elevated that monument to him after he passed away, because he liked so much the intellectual and artistic activity of Arras. That's the first reason, the attachment that, and also how Arras society was very influent in the area. The second reason, it's because of what you see under description. Concrete bust, the present statue you see there, replacing two bronze originals. The 1909 original was molten by the German during World War I. So, no wonder why we don't have anymore that many trays from that beautiful time. Those bronze were molded by the German during World War I. After the war, it was replaced by a new bronze bust, which in turn, in World War II, was destroyed. After that war, it was replaced by the present concrete copy. It's much cheaper than bronze, isn't it? Huh? Next slide. Well, that's for my uncle Octave. He's the one who did the lady you see there. Well, the whole monument, but especially the lady. Because he was hiring sculptor too, and that soldier really to go to fight on the right was done by Millet. And you can see that presently in the Arras Cemetery. Next slide. So that just to give you an idea, those artists, they were also entrepreneurs. And My uncle Octave and his father before him had a big workshop that about 60 to 80 workers in Arras and that 200 in Belgium, where you have beautiful marble quarries. And there on the field on the right. Next slide. Next one. Okay. I told you my ancestors were in wrought iron. It was a tradition to give a business to each of your son. And my great-grandfather had three, actually the generation before anyway, had three sons. And that's why he created that company, Saint-Sauveur. And if I bring it to you, it's because actually, well, he's a man who died when he was 49, and his widow decided to take over. We were in the 19th century. She was not going to head three factories, if we can say. So she kept on with the traditional line of the family, if we can say. Well, it was already about 100 workers, you know, mostly male workers, of course, if you are in the iron business. Huh? But that particular place that my great-grandfather founded with two friends, Saint-Sauveur, became quite famous. And actually, they're the one who built the subway in Atlanta. Except that the contract for the Atlanta subway was signed in American dollar and not in French francs. And by the time the half of the subway was already built, the American money fell a lot. And so the amount of money the Americans were giving to that company just was divided by two. The French government had warranted the construction, if I can say. So actually, the French government decided that they will pay directly all those workers in order they can complete the work. So now you know that half of the Atlanta subway was built with French money. Literally, they are the taxpayers who pay for it. And of course, that manufacturer doesn't exist anymore. But I realize that what they have done, and especially their garden furniture, were really very much in demand in England. You may hear about the name Grassin-Ballédan, Saint-Sauveur and Grassin-Ballédan, it's the same basically. And my is my grandfather, who not only inherited from the wrought iron business of his dad, but he decided to bring the central heating to Arras in the 19th century. So those artists, as I said, they were also entrepreneurs. And I must say it's good because definitely you cannot live only with wrought iron. Next slide. Here is a map of Arras in 1900. You still see roughly the configuration with the town. We see a little less the city, but we see at the bottom left, we see the citadel, which is a little bit cut. And but what we see especially, it's the railroad. And that was, of course, a big change at that time. You see also under that diagonal, from bottom left to top right, you see a kind of triangle, it's written Rie. And that was quite important for the troops, the British troops in the First World War. I will not comment too much about that, but I just wanted to pinpoint that. Next slide. So here is how the big market was when my father was born in 1907. You see all those Hispano-Flemish houses around the market. You see all the people on the square, the belfry on the right side, and you see a railroad on the floor because the train was going up to the market. Next slide. Next slide. So that's the entrance of that big market. The entrance of the city too, with what is called a péage. It's also public way. Well, where the people coming from outside the city had their carriage wait because there were some tax to pay, some local tax when you were going to the market. By the way, that small building still exists. It was destroyed during the war, but it was rebuilt identically. Next slide. 1914, August 3rd, Germany declared war against France. German forces invaded Belgium and northern France. Beginning of September, already there was a fire from bombing, from shelling in the Belfry. But the Belfry itself was shelled with one shell every minute. For an hour and 19 minutes, well, a little less, I think it's 69 shell, but it was big diameter shell that finally get rid of that beautiful Gothic belfry that had been built under Carlos Quintos. What a destruction. At that time, so you see, we were in October. It was just 2 months after the beginning of the war. Of its 27,000 inhabitants, only 1,500 were left. And my father and his brother and sister and their mom were on the shore of Normandy. Next slide. Next one. 70 to 80%, according to the source you read and also the building you consider, of the city were destroyed during the First World War. Here is the cathedral. You see the roof completely gone, the side too. On the right, a street not very far from the Belfry. At the bottom, that big Grand Place. Next slide. Next. Here it's the building in front of the station, the train station. Next slide.
I'd like to make a comment at this point, Thais.
Yeah.
I can see on my other computer the remaining slides that there are, and at the rate that we are going, you will not be able to go through all of the slides. Okay. You're currently on slide 76, I believe, and yeah, you will be, there are quite a few. So you will have to either accelerate, or unfortunately, yeah, you will be cut off before the end of the, yeah, session.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, so, thank you. So next slide. Okay, so here is the front line. And you see Arras there in the north. Next slide. Next slide. Okay. Oh, no, you went a little too fast. Just before. Okay. So here is a 1914 assessment. Destruction of most of historical heritage. Two square, belfry, town hall, Sanva Cathedral and Palace. And for a good reason, you know. Well, from the belfry was built to see what was going on away. The Germans were just at the border of the city. Actually, I grew up on the battlefield. So, and so they were shelling everything that was in height, everything from which you could see them, you could this maneuver. Next slide. The British were fed up of that front line that did not move between 1914 and 1917. And in December 1916, they had a bright idea, many bright ideas. They told to the French headquarters, look, well, I must say, they were in Arras already, hein, to help French people. And they told, look, we are going to give a diversion battle in the spring around Arras, and a week after, you French people, you will be able to attack on the Marne. Okay? And how did they organize? The British knew about those quarries. You have seen those beautiful limestone that so many houses in Arras were built with. Well, that was coming from a quarry not very far from that Rie. And actually around Babom Street. And that quarry was underground. They decided that will be the quarters for the soldier. And actually, it's 24,000 soldiers that were lodged in that underground quarry. Next slide. Next. Yeah. Okay. So, too bad I don't have a mouse. On the right, you see the front line. Huh? And you, the German was were on the right, the ally on the left. And so you see how close they were to Arras. And on the left map, the quarry, it's where you have all those New Zealander and Australian world, and Wellington Quarry, it was called, because the New Zealander, tipped by whoever, I don't know, but they dig tunnels from Arras to Mont-Saint-Éloi. I told you that there used to be a tunnel from downtown Arras to the Mont-Saint-Éloi Abbey that just happened just in front of the Vimy Ridge. So, indeed, when the Canadian soldiers were part of the Allied troop, they were part of the British, went to fight, they first took a tunnel from Wellington Quarry for 10 kilometers up to Mont-Saint-Éloi Abbey, that was, of course, in ruins. And the German people in Vimy, on the top of the ridge, they saw those people coming from nowhere. That was a tremendous surprise, and you know, it was a big victory. That was unfortunately the only big victory. Next slide. So we'll go very fast. All those houses that were bombed, MH, it's classified monument historique. That's why it was built back identically. Next slide. Other houses, if you look well, you know, they're standing, you wonder how. Next slide. Okay, the belfry. Well, everything that was classified monument historique was rebuilt identically, I said. Yeah, but what do you mean by identically? The belfry, for instance, was built with a structure in reinforced concrete. Is someone, François Hanbeek, an engineer who was living very close to Arras, who invented reinforced concrete. So Arras people knew very well about that technique, and they called specialists to rebuild their historical monument with inside reinforced concrete, and outside they use as many old stone as they could. But it had to look exactly like the way it was before. from outside. Next slide. Inside, not only they had reinforced concrete, but sometimes they did some little twist, if I can say. And you see, for instance, that stair and beautiful banister that had been built by Léon Boucher, the grandfather of my father. And well, of course, I told you the town hall was burned as well as the belfry. And that piece of iron rod that I have at my home here in Montreal has been in that fire. And is my dad, who was a teenager, went in the ruins to pick up a piece of what his grandfather had built. But he was later on asked by the Monument Historique, because he was the best in France. He had the prize of Meilleur Ouvrier de France for wrought iron. And so he was asked to do that new banister, and this time in Art Deco. Next slide. As well, you have seen that Hotel de Beaufort that became the boys' high school. Whatever needed to be fixed with the stone was fixed according to the 18th century plan, but the fence was a new fence, Art Deco. Next one. Same in the city. See, so that's Place du Théâtre. The houses were in ruins. It was built back, and you might see there are some ceramic on it. We will go very fast because of time through all those pictures. So, Gordon, could you just leave us, let's say, 10 seconds for each slide of the houses? See, those beautiful. Once again, you know, all that was rebuilt, but this time in Art Deco style. That's Place du Théâtre. Galerie Moderne, which is on the fourth side of that Place du Théâtre. Rue Nonestal, it's a little bit further. Again, Art Deco. Again, Art Deco. Wrought iron. Some fancy other style. Okay, we stop on this one. This one is just in front of the Palais Saint-Va, and in my ad, if I can say, in my proposal, I spoke of Louis le Prince Ringuet. You see on the right, just behind that sign forbidding the circulation, you see a grey building. It was actually the Collège Saint-Joseph, where Louis le Prince Ringuet went to school. His primary school and beginning of his high school. Next slide. That école maternelle, it's preschool, you know, from 3 to 5. They had really, they were eager to build back those school for children, 3 to 5. Next one, another school for 3 to 5. Another house. I was always intrigued by the one on the left. I knew the people living there, and they have an Italian name, and I thought that was the reason why their house was so different. But actually, no, he was an architect from Arras. It just, he took a different style, Art Deco again. And that quite a big house. It was built actually for Hautecoeur l'Amiral. In 1924, and our mayor, Désiré de Lansomme, lives there for a little while. There too, actually, you have a beautiful get down. Some detail. Well, of course, when you had some bronze, it was coming from Paris. But look at the carving too, how beautiful it is. So that's all the Art Deco. Art Deco went into churches, and so that's Saint Jean-Baptiste, the only church that had not been destroyed during the Revolution, was destroyed by the war, except for the floor. And, well, that was damaged, but so the iron fence, you see the delicacy of that work. Can go to the next one. Glass window. Those ones were done in Paris by the atelier Maumet-Jean. beautiful glass windows. Saint Va Cathedral, you have seen how it was destroyed. Next one. So it was rebuilt too. See how grand it is. Next one. That's the altar, an artist from Paris who did all those bronze. Here, local artist, but beautiful. Art Deco again. See, you have that blend of traditional and new. The big organ at the very back. Next one. Some detail. Next one. So here, see the chair, the front bed. See again, Art Deco. Next one. So if you like Art Deco, definitely go and visit Arras. Of course, with so many soldiers from Great Britain, from Netherlands, I mean from New Zealand, from Australia, Canada, and so on, South Africa, China, India, who died around Arras. There are so many cemeteries around, and inside Arras, there is that memorial of the missing for the 35,000 soldiers. No, it's the other way? Okay, here is an aerial view of that building for the missing. Next one. I put that, it's where French people from resistance in the citadel were shooted during the Second World War. Second World War did damage. The first bomb fell on my grandmother's house, but it was far, far less damages than the First World War. Next slide. And so, what is left to see in Arras? Most of the sea you have already seen can still be seen because they have been rebuilt identically for everything that was historical. You might like to see, so next slide. Yeah, next slide. That's who it is nowadays. Next slide. Okay, you might like to see Saint-Nicolas en Cité, which is built where the Gothic Cathedral was. And here is the map, and it shows that church, which is big actually, it's only the size of one transept of that big cathedral. Look, and in that particular church, you have beautiful woodwork all around. Next slide. Beautiful paintings too. Next slide. Especially that triptych de Clessence from 1577 that come from an abbey. And that's the detail of that triptych, which is really beautiful. And some other Rubens and paintings that are so nice even when they are unknown. And for those more interested by the story of Notre Dame des Ardents, there is a church that was built in its honor. It was built only in the 19th century, here you see it, but according to the Byzantine Roman Gothic style of the 12th century. And it has a beautiful organ. Now, the current Palais Saint-Va, you see at the very back the cathedral, we spoke already about it, and in front, what used to be the monks' building has been changed by a museum of fine arts and city mediatheque. That's the entrance of the museum with a nice courtyard. Next slide. That's where you enter in the museum. Inside the museum, so many medieval statues, but it's also the architecture. That's the room for the temporary exhibition. Yeah, beautiful stair and both local item. Of course, a number of tapestry. Next one. But also the painting on cardboard that allow you to see the difference between how it was before it was made, and how those people who weave those tapestries were really skilled. They, from something ordinary, they did something exceptional. You have also quite a number of very nice oil on canvas, like Philippe de Champagne. Next one. And in a remote church of Arras in the new district, you have that wrought iron by my dad, and I like especially Lady Mary. It's so tender. You know how you can do with iron something so so nice. Next one. You have historical celebration in Arras. One of them is Giant Parade. Another one is the nautical joust that have happened in Arras for centuries. Next one. That's the countryside. You see how beautiful it is, how peaceful. That's what inspired Corot. Next one. And that's it. That's the last one. Question. We see lion from Arras that was at the top of the belfry and fall down, and it was saved in the ruins. And okay, maybe we can stay on the lion and give me your question. I'm ready to entertain any question. I'm sorry, I rush, but...
No, it went well, I believe, Therese, it went well. The latter part was more visual and therefore could be seen quickly. A couple of comments from the members. Charlotte French saying it was a wonderful presentation, that Judy enjoyed it. Suzanne Purcell, most interesting talk. Madeleine Sebald, thank you, Therese, a wonderful presentation. One question that did come up here, let me get here. A few more other comments. One comment from Peter Roberts, who said, the building Mont Saint-Pierre, was it built for? You mentioned that bankers charging high rates for lending money. Could you comment on that, please?
Yeah. I don't know by the detail, but what I have understood, because as a child, of course, I asked my parents what it was for. So basically, you could leave there some kind of... something that was valuable, and it's like a mortgage. You know, you leave something precious, and you are given money, but the right amount of money in exchange, and without any interest or very, very low interest. And it was based on some kind of volunteer work, but by knowledgeable people. I must say, I have, I could be something about that, but I, for some reason, I left my paper because indeed, but you know what I could do? It's send him. Is Peter Roberts?
Yes, it's me.
Peter, definitely. You know, I can send you some more information about that.
Okay, thank you.
One comment that Peter did make, which I want to share with you, Therese, and I think you'll feel proud about that, is that his favorite was the 1967 wrought iron Madonna and Child, which was done, I think, by your father.
Oh, yeah. Oh, thank you so much. Yeah. I have seen it. You know, that picture was taken on the dining table I have here that I moved from Arras. And I have seen also the drawing from the architect who did but it was just a sketch, you know. And I was a teenager, and I mentioned to the architect, you know, well, how different it is, and how gorgeous the work my dad has done. And the architect told me, yes, you know, I knew that by giving that sketch to your dad, you would do something really exceptional. Yeah, thank you.
Any other comments? Timmy, could you unmute yourself?
Just to say thank you very much. It was very interesting and I've learned a lot. Thank you, Therese.
Well, you're welcome, Timmy. I wish, you know, I thought preparing that talk that I might do it only about middle age, because with people like Adam Lal and there was so much that we could speak of. I am sure you knew about Le Jeu de Robin et Marion by Adam Lal, and it's quite a step for musicians, that musical play in a vernacular language.
One comment here from Gail saying, thank you very much, very interesting. Your personal history and comments were wonderful to hear. Indeed, I can second that thought, that the way in which you interwined really 500 years of history with your own personal experiences was made the talk very, very interesting. It's quite different. It's not something that you could read in a book. You know, you read certain details in a book, but the way in which you presented your own history and were able to weave in, if you wish, particularly those images of the work that your father had done, that made it most interesting. A lot of material to put through in 2 hours. Thank you ever so much.
Thank you. Viviane has a question, I see. Viviane, she needs to be unmuted.
Two things I just discovered. I have songs by De La Halle, and it's by the ensemble Claude Gervaise. And another thing is, I'd love to have the references, because this, I was raised in Belgium, so I learned the history. Arras was part of the history as well, of Belgium.
Yeah, of course, yeah.
Tev, you had a question?
I'd like to have the reference, a copy of the references that you gave at the on the last slide. Is it possible to?
Yes, okay. We can distribute that. Tev?
Yeah.
I simply wanted to follow the point that Gordon was making. It was a remarkable presentation, exceptional. So because of your link, your personal link to the city and to its history, and that gave it much more immediate meaning, and it was just not quite a tourist presentation, but an experience for me personally. Thank you.
Oh, thank you. Thank you very much.
Moi, je suis complètement d'accord. I agree with what Gordon and Tev said. It was beautiful.
I can see from the smiles on people's faces that several people are in agreement.
Thank you.
Okay, one last question for you, Therese. Do you have any objections that your slide presentation be distributed to the people who attended this conference?
No problem.
Okay, then I have the mailing list, and therefore what I will do is I will convert the PowerPoint presentation into a PDF, okay, PDF, which okay. I can mail, and I will mail to everyone, and this way everyone will have the various images that they've seen, they'll be able to look at it as they want, and of course the last slide, which is the references, which I think was Vivian you were asking for. So everyone will have all the material and be able to look up more information if they do want to do this.
Okay. Yeah, thank you. And don't hesitate to write to me if you want some more information.
Yeah, okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for everyone for having attended this particular session. Bye now.